We're just going to continue. Well, we're going to continue. We're going to start rather our worship service this morning. So if you are able, please do stand and join with me as we just lift up our voices and enter into the Lord's presence this morning. You know, I just really do feel that God is with us in this place. God is here. And let's just spend time with the Lord as we lift up our words, our notes, our very presence, our beings to the Lord this morning. Let's just connect, because that's what we're doing. When we worship, we just connect with the Lord, you know, and let's just lift up these words, these love songs to the Lord this morning of, you know, our affection towards the Lord, because he is good. God is good. He's amazing. Even when we're going through the difficult times and all the good times, he's always there and he is good, being with us in every situation. So let's just lift up our praise and our worship this morning, and let's just spend time with the Lord. Who breaks the power of sin and darkness, whose love is mighty and so much stronger, the King of glory, the King above all kings, who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder and leaves us breathless in awe and wonder, the King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You laid down your life. That I would be set free. Whoa, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Who brings our chaos back into order? Who makes the orphan a son and daughter? The King of glory, the King above all kings. Who rules the nations with truth and justice? Shines like the sun in all of his brilliance. The King of glory, the King above all kings. Come on, church. This is amazing grace.
Yes, it is.
This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You laid down your life. That I would be set free. Whoa, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Okay. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy, worthy, worthy. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You laid down your life. That I would be set free. Whoa, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. All that you've done for me, Lord. Thank you.
Yes, Lord. We thank you for all that you have done for us, for all that you are doing for us, and for all that you will continue to do for us. And we thank you for this opportunity for us to gather in your name this morning, that we can sing our praise to you, that we can hear what you have to say to us. So, Lord, I pray that you fill each of us up with your Spirit this morning, that we may have a sense of your presence and your love and your abounding grace for each and every one of us, that we will know that we are truly welcome in this space. Lord, we ask this in your name. Amen. Good morning, everyone. Welcome to the Shore community. I'm Nick, one of the ministers here. It's great to have all of you guys here this morning and however many of you are online as well. So we've got a few things to share. The first of those is that we, as always, have coffee in the cafe after the service, but we also have extra cake this morning because it was Ginny's birthday in the week, and we get to celebrate that. So a big happy birthday to you, Ginny, and a big thank you for the cake as well. Apparently it is a big cake, so we can all join in with that, and thank you to Ginny for sharing in that. This evening we have, tomorrow evening, we have a prayer meeting. Not this evening, I'm not going to be there anyway. But tomorrow evening we have our usual fortnightly prayer meeting over Zoom, and that's at 7:45. So we'll be really praying into our church community and into our world and into our nation in what has been a very turbulent week. So please do join us if you're able to. If you haven't had the link for that, do drop us a line, have a chat with us after the service, and we can get a link sent over to you. So 7:45 on Zoom, everyone is welcome to that. Coffee Plus is taking place this Thursday, that's at 10:30 in the cafe space. It's that real opportunity to gather together, to have lots more cake and coffee, and to be able to chat together. And I believe that Jamie is going to be sharing the talk this Thursday. So, I mean, maybe don't bother going, but it will be a really good opportunity to hear from Jamie as well and to share together. On the 24th of July, so that is not next Sunday, but the Sunday after, we are having a family service being coined as Get the Summer Started. So it's going to be a bit of a family service special. There's going to be lots of things taking place within the service itself. And then after the meeting, we're going to be having a summer fair as well. We're going to be celebrating the start of the school holidays, and there will even be an ice cream sundae spectacular. And lots of other things as well. So it might be a really good opportunity for anyone who has the money from when they were given that for the talents, and to be able to use that talent in whatever way you can. And maybe if you wanted that platform, that opportunity to be able to create something to sell at the summer fair, that would be brilliant. So maybe a plant stall or some summer-themed arts and crafts, whatever comes to your mind, whatever gifts you feel that you can bring to that. And just a reminder that for the talents, for the fundraising, the money goes towards the Haven as a project and all the work that is doing. Also, just a reminder about the Holiday Club. So Holiday Club is going to be taking place Tuesday the 26th to Friday the 29th of July. And we're really excited for that, but we do need just a few more volunteers. So it would be brilliant if you're able to commit some or even all of that time. It's just 2 hours a day, so it's just Tuesday to Friday, 10 till 12 each of those days, and then we're going to have a barbecue on the Friday evening. And we kind of still need help across the board in a few different areas. So if you are able to help, please do come to Jamie or myself, and it would be brilliant to have a few more volunteers for that. Also, on the subject of volunteers, you will notice that Carla, the brilliant Carla, is always at the back every single Sunday running the video desk and the stream, and she does the coffee and does lots of different things, and she is brilliant, but she can't do it all, and she also needs a break sometimes, don't we all? So it would be brilliant to build up more of a team for the video desk, to be able to have more people taking part in that. It's actually a really fun job to do. I mean, I would happily do that rather than talk to all of you guys, but, you know, I kind of have to do this bit. So, but it would be brilliant if there was a few people, maybe some of the youth as well, who wanted to have a go with that. It's good fun, and to be able to just work the video, zoom in on different people, not too much, but it would be a really fun thing to do. So if you're up for joining in with that, please do have a chat with me or Jamie, or particularly with Carla, and it would be great to build up a bit more of a video team for each Sunday. Just a very quick reminder, this is in the weekly email, so do read it for more details. But if anyone is interested in baptism, if anyone is feeling more increasingly compelled that they would like to be baptized, we would love to have a chat with you about that. Or if someone is feeling that they might like to become a member of the church, that would be also a brilliant thing. So please do have a chat with Jamie or myself if you're interested in either of those things. But now we're going to be taking up the offering together. It would be great if we could have a few volunteers who can just help take the baskets around. And we're going to be moving into that time of offering. So that is that opportunity for people to be able to give to the church. If this is your church, if you come here regularly and you feel able to give in whatever way possible, it helps continue the work of the church, because we really rely on the members, on the congregation, for this church to be able to continue and to flourish as well. Awesome, thank you, volunteers. And at this point in the service, the kids are going to be heading out. So that's the kids' church. And are the youth staying in the service today? Are we just... Oh, they're going out. Cool, brilliant, Dan, thank you. And the youth are going to be heading out and going upstairs as well. What was that? The youth are downstairs. Okay, youth are downstairs. Okay, as long as you go in that general direction, people will direct you as you go through there. I'm just going to quickly pray for the kids and the youth as they head out. Lord, we thank you for every single young person in this church community. We thank you for the blessing that they are to us, that they bring life to this church. And we thank you for the wonderful work that the kids and the youth team do as well for those young people. So we pray for them this morning, that they can just hear what you have to say to them through the leaders, that they can just really feel that this is their home, that they are a part of this community, of this family, and that they can feel increasingly connected to you, Lord. Amen. Brilliant. Back over to Dave and the worship team. Back over to Jamie.
Okay, folks. It'd be really good, I think, for us to pray this morning and to take a time to pray for all the different situations that are going on in our lives, but particularly what's happening in our kind of national conversation at the moment and the things that are going on. So we know that God is able to do more than we can ask or imagine, don't we?
Yes.
Sometimes it can be hard to believe that. Sometimes we can say the words, but we need to allow that truth to sink into our hearts. Remember, God is the Lord of all. He's the Lord of history. He's bigger than the forces that move in politics and society and culture. Nations rise, nations fall. People rise, people fall. God is here forever. Remember what it says about the the grass of the fields, here today, gone tomorrow. Remember, God is over and above all these things. And sometimes we can feel kind of overwhelmed by things that are happening in our lives or in the bigger picture happening in the world or our communities. We have a real opportunity as the people of God, as the church, to dig in and pray. And situations will change. God's will be done. Amen. So I just invite you just to close your eyes with me for a second. What we're going to do is we're going to take a little moment, because I appreciate you come in, you've been rushing, get to church, sunny day. We need a moment just to center ourselves and to focus on the presence of God. So we're going to do that. And then I'm going to say a short prayer. And then after that, I'm going to invite you to stand with me. And we're going to repeat together, if you would like to, a prayer. I don't need it just yet, thanks. You can take it off just for a second. We're going to say a well-known prayer together, if you would like to, just to end that time together. But let's just start with a moment of peace and stillness. If you come to church today with things that are burdening you, that are on your heart, bring them now before the Lord. He knows, he sees. We often talk about Jehovah Jireh, our provider. Actually, that's a really bad transliteration of the Hebrew, which is Yahweh Yireh, the God who provides, but also the God who sees. It can mean both of those things. God sees. He sees your need. He sees the situation. He sees the suffering, the confusion, the need. And he provides the solution, the healing, the wholeness, the freedom. God sees. God provides. Father God, Lord of all, King of the nations, Lord, we bring our nation to you today. In all its beauty, in all its joy, in all the things that we love to celebrate, and in all its need, in the emptinesses, in the lack. Holy Spirit, will you fill this nation? Will you fill your people? Will you rise up your church? Lord, will you have your way? Lord, we pray particularly for our government in times of uncertainty. In times of brokenness. Lord, will you raise up a generation of godly leaders, men and women whose hearts are thrilled with the desire to serve others rather than serve themselves, who are not in love with power but are in love with goodness. Whose longing is not for personal gain, but for the gain of their brothers, their sisters, this nation, Lord, our communities, for the enriching not of bank accounts, but the enriching of lives, of spirit, Lord. Have your way, Lord. We pray for our government, we pray at a national level, at a local level, raise up, Lord, a godly people. In the name of Jesus, amen. And just as I was thinking about praying this morning, it always starts with praying out widely into the context, globally, nationally, internationally, whatever it might be. But then it always comes back in my prayers to me. I hear the voice of the Spirit answering, yes, but what about you? Because it starts here, doesn't it? It's very easy to point the finger and say, that's wrong, and that's wrong, and that's wrong, and that's wrong. But as someone once said, every time you point the finger, there are three fingers pointing back at you, aren't there? So I want to be the kind of leader that I wish I had. I want to be the kind of mentor. I want to be the kind of servant. I want to be the kind of person. I want to be the kind of family member, husband, father. I want to be the kind of person that I would like to have in my life. We always want to aspire to that higher place. And one of the best and the finest prayers that I've ever encountered, that many of you might have encountered, I'm sure will have done in the past, is the prayer of St. Francis. So, Paul, if you could pop up the first bit, just have a quick read through of the words. The invitation for us to be everything that we hope others will be in this world. And then the next page. If you feel happy to read those words, to pray those words with me, please stand with me if you're able to, or you can stay seated if that's more comfortable. If we go back to the first page, and then perhaps together, if you're comfortable to do that, let's say this prayer together out loud. Lord, make me an instrument of your peace. Where there is hatred, let me sow love. Where there is injury, pardon. Where there is doubt, faith. Where there is despair, hope. Where there is darkness, light. Where there is sadness, joy. O divine Master, grant that I may not so much seek to be consoled as to console, to be understood as to understand, to be loved as to love. For it is in giving that we receive, it is in pardoning that we are pardoned, and it is in dying that we are born to eternal life. Amen.
Church, we could continue now. Now, we can do all things through Christ Jesus who gives us strength. All things. There's times when we think to ourselves that a situation may be too big. Can feel like it's too big for us, but certainly not for the Lord. You know, we can do all things through Christ Jesus who gives us strength. Because we can call out to the Lord, we can lay our burdens, cast our burdens upon him, and he will hear, and he provides, and he strengthens. He's in those situations. So let me just encourage you, as Jamie was saying as well, let's just lift these issues to the Lord. Every situation that we are concerned with, or that we want to give thanks to, but just lift it up to the Lord today. Speak Jesus over these situations. I just want to speak the name of Jesus over every heart and every mind. I know there is peace within your presence. I speak, Jesus. I just want to speak the name of Jesus till every dark addiction starts to break, declaring there is hope and there is freedom. I speak, Jesus. Your name is power, your name is healing, your name is life. Break every stronghold, shine through the shadows, burn like a fire. I just want to speak the name of Jesus over fear and all anxiety, to every soul held captive by depression. I speak, Jesus. Your name is power, your name is healing, your name is life. Break every stronghold, shine through the shadows, burn like a fire. Your name, your name is power, your name is healing, your name is life. Yes, Lord. Break every stronghold, shine through the shadows, burn like a fire. Shout Jesus from the mountains, Jesus in the streets, Jesus in the darkness over every enemy. Jesus for my family, I speak the holy name, Jesus. Come on, church, shout Jesus. Shout Jesus from the mountains, Jesus in the streets, Jesus in the darkness over every enemy. Jesus for my family, I speak the holy name, Jesus. Shout Jesus. Shout Jesus from the mountains, Jesus in the streets, Jesus in the darkness over every enemy. Jesus for my family, I speak the holy name, Jesus. Your name is power, your name is healing, your name is life. Break every stronghold, shine through the shadows, burn like a fire. Your name, Jesus. Your name is power, your name is healing, your name is life. Break every stronghold, shine through the shadows, burn like a fire. I just want to speak the name of Jesus over every heart and every mind, 'cause I know there's peace within your presence. I speak, Jesus. Just keep our focus on the Lord. God is here with us in this place. Keep our focus on Him this morning and in every situation. He's never failing. He'll never leave. He'll never forsake. He'll guide us by His Spirit He's always there, providing, loving, blessing, strengthening, caring. You call me out upon the waters, the great unknown, where feet may fail. There I find you in the mystery, in oceans deep, my faith will stand. And I will call upon your name, and keep my eyes above the waves. When oceans rise, my soul will rest in your embrace, for I am yours, and you are mine. Whoa. Your grace abounds in deepest waters, your sovereign hand will be my guide. Where feet may fail and fear surrounds me, you never failed, and you won't start now. And I will call upon your name, and keep my eyes above the waves. When oceans rise, my soul will rest in your embrace, for I am yours, and you are mine. Whoa. You are mine. Whoa. We worship you, Lord. We thank you, Jesus. Spirit, lead me where my trust is without borders. Let me walk upon the waters, wherever you will call me. Take me deeper than my feet could ever wander, and my faith will be made stronger in the presence of my Savior. Spirit, lead me where my trust is without borders. Let me walk upon the waters, wherever you would call me. And take me deeper than my feet could ever wander, and my faith would be made stronger in the presence of my Savior. Spirit, lead me where my trust is without borders. Let me walk upon the waters, wherever you will call me. And take me deeper than my feet could ever wander, and my faith will be made stronger in the presence of my Savior. Spirit, lead me where my trust is without borders. Let me walk upon the waters, wherever you will call me. And take me deeper than my feet could ever walk. my faith would be made stronger in the presence of my Savior. And I will call upon your name and keep my eyes above the waves. When oceans rise, my soul will rest in your embrace. For I am yours, and you are mine. Whoa, whoa. You are mine. Whoa, whoa. Lord Spirit, I am yours and you are mine. Connected. And I thank you for that connection. I thank you for the love. I thank you for your presence in this place today. And as I welcome Alister to preach, I just pray in the name of Jesus, Lord, that you just speak to us today throughout. Open our hearts, open our ears, let us receive what it is that you have to say to us today. I just pray a blessing upon Alister, and I thank you, God, for your word. In Jesus' name, amen.
Morning. I think that's, that's definitely working. I'm glad I didn't do morning again. Morning online. I'm Al. If you don't know me, I have the privilege of being a leader here at the Shore Community Church. If you do know me, it's me speaking. I'm sorry. So today, I'm going to be sharing with you about how we see things. For this next bit, I'm trying to not look at anybody in particular because it can be really like... So I'm going to sort of look at the sky. What are you looking at? Has anyone said that to anyone? Anyone had that? What are you looking at? Well, that phrase has literally lost me a tooth. When, as a teenager, I had not had the blessing of James's teaching on taming of the tongue, my response to what you were looking at was, oh, a bully who's angry all the time. Whack. He hit me in the mouth, which actually, as I was kind of going on the ground, because I did dramatically fall on the ground, as I was going on the ground, I thought to myself, why did you hit me in the mouth when it was the eye you had a problem with? I would have pointed that out had my mouth not been full of tooth. So, did I learn a lesson from this? Well, not immediately, because actually I have to confess that subsequently I have been hit a couple more times. Not in the last 30 years, but always for not actually being able to keep my mouth shut. I have never hit back. Now, is there anything for us to learn? Yes. Read the book of James, specifically James 3. But much more on the message this morning. This is an introduction to eyes, really. And I'm focusing on how I and we look at others, how I or we look at ourselves, and how God looks at us. Now, our eyes. So let's start with our eyes. And from what I know about eyes, they are ridiculous. This takes a picture, this takes a picture, they merge together and give you a picture. That's staggering. And so when we, slight sidetrack, but when anybody says, Anyone comes up with this random theory about how we can randomly be made, and everything about our body, but particularly our eyes, come on. So it's little wonder that the Bible pays particular attention to our eyes. Interesting that a key aspect of how we talk about our walk has an eye reference. Give me vision. The Bible is a sea of seas. I like that. Everywhere Jesus goes, he sees, and people see him. The eye is the window to the soul, sort of, but actually, our perception of what we see and how we filter it is, in my view, the window to the soul. So if you like, I think the eye is a doorway. Things come into our eyes, and it's what we perceive or imagine that counts. So we've got these pictures that are coming in, they come into our brain, and miraculously, and it's the message that the brain sends back that I'm interested in. So we're going to have an example. Here we have something that we're going to look at, and then we're all going to get a brain message, and I'll be interested to know what. So our brain message might be, shark, swim away. Or as others, although I think Graham, those who like deep sea diving are really into it, I think Graham once said, oh, I really like sharks. Yeah, I'd swim towards them. So we do have different perceptions of this car. This car, I think, is a, my boy will tell me exactly what this car is, but I think it's a Bugatti. This car, what does it say to us? Buy me. You will make me be important. Different emotions are created. Ah, squirrels cuddling, I want one, two. Ooh. We all have different reactions. How do I look at others? For me, this can be split. Those who I love and I am close to. Those who I don't know that well and those who I don't know at all. So all of these groups, and I think there's no science here. I think we've all got groups like that in our lives. So all of these groups of people are equal in God's eyes. But they are not necessarily equal in my eyes. And this is an issue. Those who are in my crowd, in my in crowd, are welcomed in. My family, close friends could do no wrong. They are my tribe. We have similar ethics, lifestyles, life experiences. They are easy to love and comfortable to be around. The judgment in my mind for these people is soft and considerate. It's easy to see my tribe as I imagine God does. In his gospel, Luke reports Jesus sharing, if you love those who love you, what credit is that to you? Even sinners who love those who love them. Even sinners love those who love them. And if you do good to those who are good to you, what credit is that to you? Even sinners do that. So Jesus challenges us by how we look at others. And when we look at others outside our tribe, what do we see? What are we looking for? What are we looking at? What are you seeking to decide what your view is of someone? Do you even have the right to have a view? Now, this isn't meant in any way to shame us. I am interested to know, as I fall down occasionally here, I'm just interested to know, I fall down here, what we can look at a car someone drives, the job that they have, all the filters that the world, and I feel like saying the word, spitting the word world, but the world tells us to look out for. Are they a threat to us? or our well-being, or our prosperity? Is their world saying they've done better than us? Are we reading they're better than us? Or could they comfortably fit into our tribe because they're very much like us? Whose glasses are we wearing when we are looking at others? Now, I know Jess shared on this last year. Are we looking at the, or partly, so, are we looking at the world's glasses? Now, the world's glasses would definitely be manufactured by a designer brand, no doubt. So we're going to call them CK. So the world's glasses are CK glasses. There they are. Little. That's what the world says. For the glasses, for the way we look, is all about material items, or certainly the Western world. God's glasses are manufactured by compassion and love, CL. So not CK, but CL, compassion and love. So that's the frame with which how we're seeing others and how we're seeing others. Now this next video clip, if you're of a certain generation, tech willing, just is another way of looking at how we look at others. Now this made a real big impact on me as a teenager. There's no HD telly back then. and particularly I was warned about skinheads.
An event seen from one point of view gives one impression. Seen from another point of view, it gives quite a different impression.
Oh, is it not coming up?
But it's That's only when you shame. Get the whole picture you can fully
I can
understand
see it on my screen.
What's going on.
That's such a shame. So we've got the words, you can imagine.
An event seen from one point of view gives one impression. Seen from another point of view, it gives quite a different impression.
We're going to move on. That's a shame. Great video. You can imagine. Some of you might remember it, but it did make an impact on me. Effectively, the skinhead looks like he's running towards a guy to steal his bag, and he's actually pushing him out of the way because some rubble falls down. That's what happens. So our eyes cannot and should not interpret what is in someone else's soul. That's illogical, yet we do it all the time. Let's open the Bible. Let's look at the story of Zacchaeus. Now, the words are up there, so there we go. It's all here. This just ticks every box. So if, as takeaway points, James 3, but actually that's a side point, read this, read it. It's all here. It's incredible. Jesus entered Jericho and was passing through. A man was there by the name of Zacchaeus. He was a chief tax collector and was wealthy. At this point, if we were a pantomime, we'd all boo and hiss, because Zacchaeus would have been widely hated. People would have seen Zacchaeus and attached all manner of things, and he would have been hated. Zacchaeus' life is just about to be changed. He wanted to see who Jesus was. Boom. But because he was short, he could not see over the crowd. So he ran ahead and climbed a sycamore fig tree to see him, since Jesus was coming that way. When Jesus reached that point, he looked up and said to him, "Zacchaeus, come down immediately. I must stay at your house today." So he came down at once and welcomed him gladly. All the people saw this. Picture, brain, what's going on? And began to mutter, "He has gone to be the guest of a sinner." But Zacchaeus stood up and said to the Lord. Interestingly here, Zacchaeus is addressing the Lord. He is not addressing the thoughts of the mutterers. Look, Lord, here and now I give half my possessions to the poor. And if I have cheated anybody out of anything, I will pay back four times the amount. Jesus said to him, today salvation has come to this house, because this man too is a son of Abraham. For the Son of Man came to seek and to save the lost. What a great story. What a great... And it's a story that it's a record of something that actually happened. It's not a parable, and we've got great learning in parables. This happened. This is a historical account. Now, I was really challenged when on holiday last month. Abby and I were having dinner in our local hotel, and a group of English holidaymakers came into the restaurant. The shirt I was wearing was linen. The shirt our new guests were wearing were football. Within 5 seconds, I decided that my dinner was going to be ruined. And within 10, I had made all manner of assumptions about their lives. How dare I? Why did I think that I had the right to do all of this? But I did, and I was wrong. My immediate plan for how my evening was going to go had been changed, and in my mind, I cursed others for not being like me. Jesus, in his Sermon on the Mount, gives clear advice on so much, but also he deals with the eyes. This is a little... Why do you look at the speck of sawdust in your brother's eye and pay no attention to the plank in your own? How can you say to your brother, let me take that speck out of your eye, when all the time there is a plank in your own eye? You hypocrite. Jesus, he had a sense of farce way before Shakespeare. And I interpret Jesus saying that we cannot clearly see without sorting out our own stuff, and that we should do that first. But I actually also think that something will happen to us in the removal of our plank that will make our brother's speck disappear or seem much less important to us. Now, jumping back to Luke, we're going to continue that narrative with Luke telling us, come on, it's easy to love each other. He goes straight into, but love your enemies. Now, we know all these. Do good to them and lend to them without expecting to get anything back. Jesus' words, love your enemies, do good to them. This must start by looking at everybody with compassion and love. Slight sidetrack, but I know that by doing this, we change how others react to us. As good as we think we are at pretending, it is pretty obvious when you are being spoken to by someone who isn't, who has formed a view of you, has given judgment upon you. And in response, we can play up to that role. I've just finished a book. No, I haven't. I've just finished the first three chapters of a book called Humankind. And then the last chapters, it sort of rolls away. But it's the first three chapters are ridiculously good. And it suggests that we are all inherently good and kind. And our instincts are generally positive. One of the many examples it provides quotes a study with a social psychology professor who has been asking the same question for years. And we're going to do this. We're going to do this just A, to prove that everyone's still awake after 10 minutes, and B, just as this experiment. So this is the experiment that he's been carrying out. Imagine an airplane makes an emergency landing and breaks into three parts. As the cabin fills with smoke, everyone inside realises we've got to get out of here. What happens? So, on planet A, the passengers turn to their neighbours to ask if they're okay. Those needing assistance are helped out of the plane first. People are willing to give their lives even for perfect strangers. Planet B, everyone's left to fend for themselves. Panic breaks out. There's lots of pushing and shoving. Children, the elderly, and people with disabilities get trampled underfoot. So I'm going to ask a show of hands, not what planet you feel you, not how you would react, but the planet that you think that you inhabit. Are you planet A? Do you think people would, we inhabit a world where everybody would look after each other, or do we inhabit a world where everyone puts everybody down? So are we planet, those for planet A, hands up, show of hands. And for planet B, so that's sort of a majority, thank you. We buck the trend slightly, because 97% of people think that we live on planet B. It does not matter who you ask, left wing or right, rich or poor, well educated or not. The truth is that, well, everybody makes the same error. The truth is that we live on planet A. Planet God made. There are countless examples from the Titanic to the plane plane that came down on the Hudson River. Don't know if anyone's seen that film. Countless examples to the horror of the World Trade Center in New York on the 11th of September 2001. This is a contemporary account of a firefighter. As the Twin Towers burned, thousands of people descended the stairs calmly. Even though they knew their lives were in danger, they stepped aside for firefighters and the injured. Going back, and people would actually say, no, you first. I couldn't believe it that at this point, people would actually say, no, please take my place. It was uncanny. Whatever we may feel, or dare I say it, religion can say about us, we are good. We do all have God in us. But when we see ourselves and others as not accepted or acceptable, these are lies, then we can react in a way that God doesn't intend. God must be in all of us, and it's up to us if we decide to see him or look for him in others and in ourselves. Our eyes cannot and should not interpret what someone else is seeing. That's illogical, yet we do it all the time. Depending on how we feel about ourselves and view ourselves, and so many past experiences that I can't unpack for now, that's not for now, depends very much on how we see others. That's unreliable. Going back to my holiday. On an excursion, Abby and I took a bus to the port city of Mahon, where actually we had gin with Julie. That's another story. On our way to Mahon, in a seat in front of us, was a lady who, across her back, had a tattoo that said, bitch. It was all the way across her back. And for good measure, it had some devil paraphernalia. It was very similar to this image, which you might not be able to see, but it was, anyway, Oh, the bitch tattoo lady. I try to pray for you every day. Looking at ourselves, how can we get to a place where we can put that curse on ourselves? When this is what we see of ourselves, when this is how we label ourselves. So we can rest easily, it's all right. We haven't got that tattoo on our back, it's not a problem. But I'm afraid that we can't. Because when we look in the mirror at ourselves, or when we judge ourselves, we're in a similar way looking at ourselves on occasions like the world does, and not through compassion and love. And when we see ourselves as unworthy, we curse ourselves. This can be low-level curses. My hair looks a mess. That's what I say whenever my hair looks a mess. It's the exact tone. To a high-level hardcore curse. I'm useless. How we may look is something massive about how we understand ourselves. And many of us bring ourselves down because of how we look, make ourselves feel low. Everywhere we look, there are images to tell us how we should look, what we should wear. And it's garbage. These are lies, and not for you. Our king, our example, the most important human that ever walked this earth. What did he look like? How tall was he? What did he wear? What colour hair did he have? How much hair did he have? Apart from a little bit in Revelation that talks about white wool hair and golden sash, we know very little. The Bible is silent about what Jesus, our King, looked like. Now, we can get clues from the times of what others may have looked like or dressed like, but we don't know. Why is this? Because it's not important. It didn't and it does not matter. So if it was not important for the writer of the Gospels to describe Jesus' physical appearance, why is it so important, certainly to most of the Western world, what individuals look like? It's nonsense. We have fallen into the worldly trap, easily done, but a lie that brings us away from God. It was likely that Jesus would have looked quite similar to his disciples because he had to be pointed out when he was betrayed. That's kind of a thought. But whose eyes are we looking at ourselves with? These material eyes, when we've established it's nonsense, or with a frame of compassion and love? How we see ourselves without God's goggles very much affects how we see others, and this is not, in my view, God's plan. In fact, it could be argued that it's against his plan. The thread that's running through this is very much, then, looking at ourselves and others in a way that God sees us. When he looks, what does he see? Now, this is a moment where I hope this will be heard. We're all in a dressing room. We're half-time, and this is the big kind of... This is the G-up, and this is truth. I'm certain that he does not see a clothing brand or a size of house or a brand of car or tattoo curses or even how we see ourselves. After all, we are unreliable witnesses. He sees a champion. He sees himself in us. He sees beauty. Isaiah shared, "Since you are precious and honored in my sight, and because I love you." And we talk about love. You know, oh gosh, There's so many moments where we can think about, if we're blessed with children, that incredible, unbelievable, undiluted love that we have for them. Times that by 10 for what God thinks about us. Zephaniah, this is to a tribe, but I think this stands for us. The Lord your God is with you, the mighty warrior who saves. He will take great delight in you, in his love. He will no longer rebuke you, but will rejoice over you with singing. Fearfully and wonderfully made. We've heard that, but do we believe it? Do we believe it when we look in the mirror? Wonderfully made. Looking at Luke's gospel, good old Luke, thank you, Luke. And as we kind of go into land here, just a final thought on how God sees us. That the amazing story of the parable of the son who goes away and stuffs up and comes back. Now, I really think that's us. And how God reacts when he turns, how his father reacts, and I think is how God reacts, when we turn up at the door and knock every time, we don't have to stuff up, we just turn up. Luke reports, bring the best robe. This is God saying this about us. We're knocking on the door. Bring the best robe and put it on him, and put a ring on his hands and and shoes on his feet, and bring the fattened calf and kill it, and let us eat and celebrate. These are words over us. No matter what, we are accepted. And God delights in us all. His eyes are full of compassion and love. And this is our example. His door is open. Every human being, everyone here, everyone we know is a unique and wonderful soul that God delights in and rejoices over with singing. Every human being is worthy. That includes all of you. Believe it. You are worthy. See yourself as such. Now, I'm going to close in prayer, but before I do, I'd just love it if we could just spend 30 seconds in silent reflection on what God, on how God sees you. Just ask God silently, how, God, how do you see me? Let me see you as you see me. God, how do you see me? So we're just going to spend 30 seconds reflecting in our own lives on how God sees you. And then I will close in prayer. Amen. And Lord, thank you that we can see or visualize in our minds all of your wonderful, perfect creation. Lord, forgive us for how we can see others. Lord, forgive us for how we can see ourselves. Lord, protect us in what we see. Make us wise in what we choose to watch. May the scales fall from our eyes. Help us to see ourselves and others as you do, through your eternal eyes of compassion and love. In your name.